people are using multiple devices. They're also buying from your website or becoming a lead by taking an omni-channel approach, in which they may see you on Facebook, then they come back to your site from Google, and then they, you know, opt in for an email newsletter, and then they convert through an email newsletter. What's causing that person to convert? And did they use multiple different devices throughout that journey? Did they use an iPhone on one and then their desktop computer on another? This is all making it hard to figure out what's producing the best ROI.
So, hello everyone. Today's podcast is going to be very informative for you all. So, our today's guest is Neil Patel. So, my first question with you will be, can you share a little bit about your journey in the world of digital marketing and how you became one of the most influential figures in the industry?
Sure. I don't know if I'm one of the most influential or even influential in the industry, but I'll give you a bit of color on my background. So I'm 38 years old right now. I started when I was around 16 years old. I created a job board. I was trying to find a job online. I couldn't find a good paying job. So I created a job board. It wasn't logical. It was just what I did. And I paid some people to help me create the job board. I spent like $1,000 or so. And once it was done, I was getting little to no traffic. And it hit me that I got to do something called marketing. You know, I was really naive being young. I should have known better, but I didn't. I saved up more money working at an amusement park, picking up trash, cleaning restrooms, used that money to pay for marketing help. And I got little to no results. So from being broke and frustrated, I had no option but to learn it on my own. I got good at it, started driving traffic to my job board. And guess what? I was still making no money. I was good at the marketing side, wasn't good at figuring out how to make money. So then at that point, I transitioned into just helping other people with their marketing. And I would cold call, I would pick up the phone, you know, and call everyone who's spending money on ads and try to convince them to use my services to help them drive more traffic. Some people signed up, some people didn't. It overall worked out quite well. It was a numbers game. And over time, I kept blogging and speaking at events and, you know, doing podcast interviews like this, and it's all helped build up the brand over the years.
Okay. Your journey is really inspiring for all of us. And I want to ask you, as a successful marketer and entrepreneur, what key principles or strategies have consistently contributed to your own growth and the success of the business you have worked with?
Omni-channel marketing has always been huge. In marketing, they say there's something called the rule of seven. When someone sees or interacts with your brand seven times, they're much more likely to evangelize it, remember it, potentially become a customer. It's really hard for someone to just see your brand multiple times from SEO or just paid Google ads or paid Facebook ads. You got to do everything from Google SEO to, or SEO, whether it's Google, Bing, or any other platform, to, you know, paid ads on the search platforms, to organic social on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok. I know it's not allowed in India though, to even email marketing and conversion rate optimization and doing podcasting and interviews and blogging, all this kind of stuff. It's a combination of everything that's really helped. The second thing that a lot of people take for granted in marketing is, how do you do something that stands out? All marketing channels eventually get crowded and they don't perform as well over time as they once did when they first came out. And the reason for that is they just get competitive because they're producing results. But how do you do something that makes you stand out? So for example, back in the day when a lot of people were charging for eBooks, I would give a lot of extremely detailed and valuable content for free. Or on the flip side, when people were charging for tools, I released a lot of them for free, which helped build up the brand and generate more traffic as well.
Great. So one more thing, your blog attracts millions of monthly visitors and your podcast gets significant listenership. So what advice would you give to aspiring content creators and marketers who are just starting into this space, looking to build a strong online presence and engage their audience?
Few things. Number one, you got to write about topics that people care about. So you can use tools like Answer the Public or Uber Sess to see what's popular or hot or trending. Like Answer the Public will take Google data from Google Suggest to show you what's hot and is starting to trend. And if you create content around those subjects, you're more likely to get views from what we've tested and seen and experienced. The second thing is, if you're getting started, is you can't just rely on your following. You got to collaborate with other people. So you can do lives on Instagram with other people in your space, and you guys can both build up your following at the same time. The other thing that you need to do is you need to be consistent. You'll find that if you're trying to build up your following and brand, it's not going to be overnight. You're not going to get the results in a year or two. It takes 3 to 5 years to really see the results. And the last thing I would mention that a lot of people forget about is you can't forget about the in-person interaction. This is great what we're experiencing here. But what's better than this is being in person, meeting each other, being face to face. You can't put a price point on that. It's invaluable. And a lot of people forget to do that when they're trying to build up their brand or market their business.
So true. I agree with your points. So one more thing. With the ever-evolving digital landscape, what emerging trends or technology do you believe will have a significant impact on marketing in the near future? And how can business leverage them to stay ahead?
So the obvious one is AI. Everyone's talking about AI, from a content creation standpoint, from an image creation standpoint. I do think AI is going to have a massive impact on marketing for those things, and it already has. I think it'll have a much bigger impact, call it a year or two, or even 3, 4 years from now when it comes to content creation. The big thing that we see in AI, the real value that a lot of people aren't talking about, is analytics. So we're moving towards a cookieless world, and people are using multiple devices. They're also buying from your website or becoming a lead by taking an omni-channel approach, in which they may see you on Facebook, then they come back to your site from Google, and then they, opt in for an email newsletter, and then they convert through an email newsletter. So what's causing that person to convert? And did they use multiple different devices throughout that journey? Did they use an iPhone on one and then their desktop computer on another? This is all making it hard to figure out what's producing the best ROI, especially when you're running marketing campaigns. Some are organic, some are paid, but they still take time, and time costs money. You could take all your data from different sources, dump it into one place. Let's say Google Data Studio or Tableau. And you can start using AI to help analyze your analytics data in real time. Because most people, when I go to conferences, like I was just at a conference called AdCon in London, and I asked the audience, how many of you guys log into your analytics on a daily basis and are actually making changes based on that? And very few people raised their hand. I'm not even talking about 5%, much less than that. AI can help analyze your analytics in real time and get you more insightful information. But the bigger thing is it can help you save money much quicker. People spend so much money on paid ads, over $100 billion being spent a year just on Google ads, and Facebook ads is quite large as well. So you start looking at those dollar amounts. And if you can just go with the approach of, hey, we're going to analyze your analytics in real time, figure out where the wastage is, and figure out where to reallocate, companies are getting a much higher ROI. I think that's the big aspect of AI that can really help companies, because content creation isn't that expensive in the first place. And the AI content creation, at least in the short run, isn't that amazing compared to what you can do from manual efforts. But the analytics portion should save companies much more money and make them much more money, in my perspective, than the content generation, because the content generation you can already get done for cheap. Yes, AI is great and it's game changing from that aspect where it helps you create content faster and more of it, but it wasn't hard to do that before anyways.
So true. So as we are talking about analytics, so while researching, I got to know that the measurement analytics play a major role in marketing success. So how do you approach tracking and analyzing marketing campaigns of you, and what key metrics do you recommend businesses to focus on their access for their performance?
So with analytics, you track your goals and your conversions. You can use any platforms, whether it's, Google Data Studio, Google Analytics, Tableau, whatever you want to use. But let's say you're using Google Analytics, you're tracking your goals and your conversion. You're looking at what channels are driving the results, whether you're looking at first touch, last touch, you're doing attribution to all touches. It's up to you on how you want to slice and dice the data. And you can do multiple variations of it to figure out what works for you. But what we find is, for each business, it's going to vary. So for our business, at our ad agency, NP Digital, and we have offices all around the world, including in India, where we help companies in India like Tata, grow their traffic and sales. When you think about it, like for us, our sales cycle is longer. So our metrics are going to be very different than an e-commerce site where you can get transactions right when someone sees your product. So the metrics that a business has to track is dependent on what's the most valuable to them.
Okay, got it. Awesome. So one more thing, I have in my mind, you have the opportunities to work with major companies and brand, as you mentioned, like Google, Microsoft, Tata, wherever, like different countries brand. So could you share a particularly challenging marketing project or campaign you were involved in, and how you overcome obstacle to achieve success?
Most marketing campaigns are hard. When people come to us, they're not coming to us with an easy solution. Like with CNN Brazil, we drove a billion, I think, of page views and additional page views in 12 months or 11 months. It was somewhere around that time frame through organic. It was a really hard milestone to achieve, but we were able to achieve it. There is no easy marketing campaign that we work on in most cases, some maybe, but majority of the big companies that are coming to us are coming with hard problems. And the way you overcome it is you break it all down on, all right, what is the goal? What do you need to do to hit that goal within that time frame? Let's say a year. What do you need to accomplish each month to make sure you hit it in that year time frame? And then you break it down. What do I need to hit each week to accomplish the task in that month? What I need to accomplish on a daily basis to hit the task that I need to complete each week, so then that way I can hit the goal on an annual basis. And then what are the people I need? And you need to go get the amazing people and make sure you're executing on each of those things. A lot of these things aren't rocket science. It typically involves brainstorming and creativity and amazing people to help with the execution. Those are the two main aspects of most of marketing campaigns when it comes to these challenges.
That's so awesome to know. One more thing, Neil. If someone is a beginner and wants to rank his blogs on Google, when I announced on LinkedIn, I'm going to interview Neil Patel. So a lot of people ask me a question, he asked with you, like how to rank a blog on Google. What are the some of the key advice that will work effectively from your side?
So everyone's using ChatGPT to create content in Bard now, and any of the AI tools, like we have an AI writer at Uber Suggest. But the first thing you need is you need your content to stand out. Google talks about double EAT, experience, expertise, authority, and trust. If you can include that in your content, you're going to be better off. So include that. The second real thing that you need is you need to keep updating your content. Wikipedia ranks for a lot of stuff on Google these days, and they have for ages. And the main reason being is they don't just publish content, they continually update it. Whenever you do a Google search, why would you want to see a result that's 3 years old? You want to see a result that's 1 week old and gives you the most relevant information. So update your content. That's the second thing. The third thing is you need links. The best way to build links is not actually through content. We found the best way to build links is giving away free tools. So those are the three ways. And if you can't build a free tool, think about what people are paying for and build a free version of that and give it away. But if you don't have the time and energy to build a free tool or the money, you can use tools like Chat, or you can use ChatGPT to help you create a tool. When ChatGPT was asked to create the game Pong, it was able to do it in 60 seconds. The point I'm getting at is you can use a lot of the AI out there to help you create a tool. You may still need a paid developer to help you get that last mile and finish the little things that are left over, but that's okay. You can get it done really affordably now.